Hi, my name's Darren Brooks. I'm a caver from Cape Range. Sometimes people call me a speleologist because I do some research work, so more sciencey based stuff rather than just exploring. On a recent visit to a cave called C215, it's an interesting cave. It's comprised of several levels. Generally, the cave's formed along joints in the limestone. This is reflected in the plan map. And it's just a widened joint formed out by solution or dissolution of the rock. But this cave also shows some fluvial features, like it's had inrushing water coming in a river. It's up on top of a ridge now, so that stream doesn't flow into the cave anymore. All that ground and stream bed is now eroded away. But we do see those features in the cave still. The upper chamber, we can free climb into and has some nice decoration in there. And most of this decoration would have formed when the cave was closed, probably. The humidity is low in the top chamber, so decoration doesn't form very readily in the upper areas anymore. And then it seems to be almost blocked till you climb down a little tiny hole at the lowest point, and you come into a small chamber, which almost seems like the end again. But luckily for us, there's a slot on one side, and we go to a tunnel, crawl down through some quite obviously formed in a still water rock where it's we call it sponge work. The rock's sharp and dissolved in all different directions, and it's like being inside a big sponge really, but just with a hole big enough for us to crawl through. And we eventually come down a climb into the main part of the joint, which is a water-filled passage. It starts off dry because we're at a higher level and it's filled up with sediments in this area through the fluvial action of waters rushing in and carrying rocks and sediment in. But about 20 meters down the pathway, we come to the start of the water, and this gets steadily deeper through the cave. In the water, we can see blind fish. This is the Miliaringa viridis, or blind cave gudgeon, as it's most commonly known as. And the blind cave gudgeon occurs in the groundwaters on the western, eastern coastal plains of the caves, of the cape. Cave is rife with life in the water, stygofauna we call that. And so there's the blind cave gudgeon. There are also blind shrimps you can see in here. It also has lots of little crustaceans which are quite hard to see with the naked eye because they're very small. And we assume these are the food source of the bigger animals like the fish. The cave goes for about 35-40 meters, and eventually the water sumps up to the roof. And that's as far as a dry caver like ourselves on our trip can go. To go beyond that, you need to have scuba gear and special training to dive in caves. And if you do go down that pathway, you can travel about 300 meters underwater and down to a depth of up to 22 meters. And beyond that point, 300 meters down the end of the cave, it's not fully explored. There's still openings, or we call them leads. There are still leads at the end of this cave. But it is a difficult dive, even for experienced cave divers. And it's not the easiest cave for normal cavers either. It's not a beginner's trip. It's a little bit of experience required to negotiate safely and to not disturb the environment too much. In this slide, we show a plan view of the cave. So it's like being up in the air looking down on top of the cave. You can see the entrance in the middle of the biggest chamber there, which we free climb into. And you see where the dashed lines are, that's the water. And eventually, we wind our way through these tunnels. We get to the end of this tunnel, which is the tunnel with airspace, and beyond that, it's fully underwater. Here's our cave just in here, so we're
going to All right.
wander into here. This is C215. We have a map of this cave. This is done old school style, basically point to point mapping with compass and inclinometer and a tape measure. And we map point to point, and then we draw our cave around that, and then take a piece of paper, we map that out on the paper, and we draw it in by hand. Nowadays, more modern mapping is done done with the computer programs, but the latest technology is laser mapping, where you use a device which then fires off like 10,000 points of laser in a second, and you can move this through the cave and you can join all those points together, and you end up with a 3D map of a cave on laser points. That is the latest technology.
Glass.
So future of your research.
So what I do is the Australian Speleological Federation keeps a database of caves in Australia. And in Western Australia, the West Australian Speleological Group has what they call area coordinators, so we can break this up into manageable chunks. So I'm the area coordinator for the Cape Range region. So what I do is I gather data about caves, you know, about their, I try to look at their the geology for of what I can understand of it, you know, their formation, try and map the cave out so we understand its volume and that gives us clues to its genesis and stuff. Collect cave fauna under a permit so we can understand what animals live in the caves. And I record all the information we get into a database. And that database is used by researchers that come from around the world that ask questions about things that may have been collected in the caves. Like I've had guys from all over the world say, you know, you have a member of Schizomidae, you know, and I'm working on these at the moment. I'd really like to see them in their native environment and see if I can collect some. Because from like 215, you've got two specimens of, for example, something like Draculoides juliana. Now, this is an unusual Schizomid. It's not really very similar to the other two species you have, and I'd like to collect some more. So I know where the location is, I know how to get in the cave, and I'll assist researchers with their future work too when they come in here. And the information is all lodged on a central database with the West Australian Speleological Group, which then is added to the Australian Speleological Federation database. So that information is available worldwide to researchers that are looking for information about caves. And not being a scientist, I tend to do the field work as much as I can, which is an interest to me. Finding and exploring new caves is one of my big interests. And mapping caves out, drawing a map of a cave so you have a representation of the void under the ground.
You've got the maps.
Yeah, so I draw the maps, I've got the maps. And just exploring, oh here's a blind shrimp. Just exploring these magical places where no one's ever been before.
Oh, that's fantastic. I use the maps like frequently at Narracore Caves. I used all their maps in the digital artwork in the site.
Got the maps, yeah.
Great.
You've got a map of this cave, so.
Great.
Did I frighten that shrimp away?
No, there is, right there. That's right there, I think that's in there. That's shrimp. Or maybe this. Go on now, you can see it. That's him swimming up there. Oh, yeah, there we go, so that's him.
I don't know if I'm getting it, but
definitely a shrimp there. I've got one before. Interesting, because in a cave near town, I was filming. I had the camera in the cave. I just dropped it in there on the stick. I was filming the shrimps, and the first time we've ever filmed them, I noted that they were swimming upside down. Little shrimps are on upside down. Little blind cave shrimps.
Yeah, right.
So these are. I think these are. Stygia caris stylifera, the little shrimps in here. We've got two species, we've got stylifera and lancifera. And they occur on different sides of the cape. But I think on this side, there's a couple of features that have both species in. This is basically an atmospheric monitor. We're measuring air pressure and temperature. So you see what the temperatures are long term in this particular cave. And I have another diver, I think
I think the barrow is the diver actually. So I hope I've got that right. Just gonna put that around there so it can't be swept away or anything stupid like that. And this will just stay in here for up to 2 years. This will log for, which is pretty impressive amount of time now. And that'll just give us, hopefully that'll give us a 2 year record of temperature variations or stability that we can actually get out of this. And barometric fluctuations. So that should certainly record our evidence here anyway, our presence, all this breathing and
everything else around the place. You should know that that's, we've been here.
But the idea generally is to see what the tidal range is in the water, because we have no idea how tidal this particular cave is. We've seen it much higher than this, the water, after we've had rainfall. We don't know how fast it comes up. We don't know whether it's turbulent or whether it seeps in very gently. We don't know whether it's just filled up with drip water and then it slowly drains down to the general water table level, or whether the water table gets charged in other places and it creeps back through the water table into these areas and slowly raises up. We just don't know how it works at all.
Not yet.
And you know, this will give us a little bit of information, but you know, it's still not a lot considering the overall picture of the whole range and the water table. I mean, even in the town water table, the general picture is that our fresh water's recharge water, but there's a suspicion that the town actually consumes fossil water mostly. And a lot of the water that's in the deeper bores right at the back of town probably is greater than 10,000 years old at least. And some of this water's been pumped out of town water supplies, which makes a significant impact on the historical record of what you can, because you can get a lot of information out of water nowadays, you know, with isotope analysis and things like that. And unfortunately, a lot hasn't been done here. So hopefully, we can see a bit more in the future. This is just another small step forward in that direction.
What is that funny looking thing there?
That white stuff, I don't know what that is there. Perhaps it may have been when it was dry and a little bit of calcite dripped onto there. It formed on there. Be honest with you, I don't actually know what it is. Right, I just need to install this water pressure diver in here. This will tell us what the depths of the water are, the fluctuations if there's rainfalls, or just general fluctuations in the water table. If there's tidal fluctuations, it'll pick those up. It'll give us the water temperature as well, so we'll know what's happening with the water, whether it's cooler or warmer, or if it changes during the year or stays constant, we don't know. So, and what I need to do is I just need to attach it to a rock underwater, so that if we get meteoric waters flooding in and it's turbulent, it doesn't get moved around up and down, so it stays at the same spot, same level. It doesn't get flicked up on a ledge or anything like that. So the idea is just to take some sturdy wire and stuff and
snug it up onto a ledge so that it can't possibly move.
Easier said than done sometimes. the reef wouldn't be there if it wasn't for the range. Now the range to reef thing is, it's an interactive process, obviously. You know, the reef wouldn't be as it is without the range, you know, with its fluctuations of fresh water going in from rainfall events, the fact that it's there so corals can build upon it. And it also wouldn't be there if it probably wasn't for the Loon Current either, you know, bringing all that warm water down from north and basically, you know, colonizing animals and things like that. It's the reef wouldn't survive without the range and without the current, probably. So it's an interactive thing, and they're all tied in together. One without the other is probably not much. So I think I'm not quite sure how you would do that, but certainly, if you go to the reef, you've got the range nearby. So that's all part of that. That experience. I'm not sure scientifically quite how you tie them together, except the fact that I think one wouldn't exist without the other. The reef wouldn't exist without the range there to, you know, for corals to build upon. And a lot of the range wouldn't be there if it wasn't for the coral building polyps. Well, the whole of the west coast and east coast platforms, the reef platforms, without them, you know, without the Ningaloo Reef, there wouldn't be any coastal platforms either. There wouldn't be any chance to interpret this stuff. All you'd have is hills going down to the sea. All the erosional processes mean you do. So I'm not sure I have a very good answer for that, Ben. At all.
Well, here's maybe a little bit of a harder question.
Some people might say I'm prattling on.
No.
I'm making stuff up before
you go. That's okay, because it sort of puts you in good standing for the next question.
Okay.
If, say, you were hypothetically an artist and you were able to break all sorts of rules and chuck out bits and pieces of information and not worry about other stuff if it didn't suit what you were on about, which was this idea of the interaction between the two, how would you broadly depict the interactions between the Loon Current and the terrestrial environments that it supports, in a way?
Well, the ankyline systems thrive on stability, but they're not that stable. I mean, the tides that come in from the ocean change ankyline environments. Ankyline environments are these freshwater seawater intermixes on the coast, where, you know, freshwater is coming in from the land, seawater is mixing there, and you get environments within caves and in the groundwater, and it's not necessarily in caves, but just in the groundwater itself and in the voids, where you've got an environment that can be totally freshwater right down to hypersaline, and with a whole bunch of different stuff mixed in, like hydrogen sulfide layers in there, anoxic layers, and the current, obviously, you know, must be changing, influencing the tides a bit too, I suppose. I guess not as much as the Earth revolving around the Sun and the Moon revolving around the Earth, I suppose. But there must be some interaction there. I don't know. I haven't mapped that out, so I wouldn't know how that would work. Well, when we talk about ankyline habitats, we talk about those caves that are on the coastal plain. They've got a mixing of fresh and salt water, so they're, like we said before, you know, it can go from fresh water right down to hypersaline with anoxic layers, hydrogen sulfide layers. But we're standing in an ankyline cave right now. The other part of the cave is not ankyline, it's a general terrestrial cave. This part of the cave is the ankyline system, and we're standing within the ankyline cave system that's under the coastal plains right now. What effect does a rise of 1 meter in the eustatic sea levels, the worldwide sea level, what change does 1 meter have on a cave like this? 2 degree change in the temperature of the atmosphere, what change does that have on the humidity levels in here? Does it get hotter? Does it get too hot? Does it stay flooded? You know, what effect does it have on the Loon Current down the coast when the shape of the coastline changes? Will the Ningaloo Reef survive the hotter water? Will it survive a change in the current, if the current doesn't come by there anymore? It's just, you know, there's a million, the more you look at it, the more questions you end up with. I don't know.
don't think we know the answers to any of those yet. We've got lots of great predictions, but predictions don't always mean answers. So, yeah, and when you stand in an ankylon habitat like this, and you've got animals that are virtually unchanged, at least, you know, for the last couple of hundred million years, these little crust microcrustaceans have stayed the same. Their little fossils show us that they had little egg sacs on their backs and they carried eggs, and you know, they had the same number of legs, and they look virtually identical to what they do now. And yet here we are standing in amongst things that are around before the dinosaurs, swimming all around us. I mean, like, even you look at scorpions and pseudoscorpions and Schizomids, micro-whip scorpions, they ran long before the dinosaurs, and here we are crawling through an ankylon cave surrounded by pre-dinosaurian fauna. And that's an incredible thought, isn't it?
It's amazing. It's amazing.
I like the thought of that. You come to these special little places, and you know, there's probably been a dozen people, different individuals in here, maybe two dozen max. And what's good for me up here, you know, being the only permanent spino, is I've been down hundreds of occasions, no one else has ever been in before. I'm the only person ever to set foot, you know, in the, I don't know, in the 15, 20 million year history of that particular cave. I'm the only person ever to wander through and light it up and see the stalactites, you know, and the cave fauna wandering around. And each time you're in there, you think, wow, these types of fauna, Schizomids and things, you know, they were pre-dinosaurian, you know, crustacea, and things swimming in the water around your feet and legs and roaming around on the mud banks by your side. This is just an amazing place. And when it comes to World Heritage, that's hardly been touched on. They talk about the geo-heritage a bit, you know, it's a fascinating place. It was once a shallow seabed, it's now risen up out the sea. We've got the Ningaloo Reef on the side, which is a big part of the World Heritage, but there's so much important stuff here, and it doesn't even get a mention most of the time. And that's the sad part too, is that we get tens of thousands of visitors every year that come right past this very special heritage we've got right here, and they never get to see it. They never get to experience it, they never get to understand that if they were to stand in here, you know, these pre-dinosaurian relics are wandering around in here, you know. We stood on a part of, you know, what was near the Gondwanan continent and the Tethys Sea breakup, right in this spot here, 45 million years ago, and the Tethys Sea started forming, whenever it was. Here we are.
These go back much further though than that as well, don't they? We're going even beyond the Carboniferous,
that's just the distribution of the continents at that time, when Australia basically drifted down over the South Pole, and the others like headed up to the Northern Hemisphere, and they're all up there now, and we're down here.
At some point during the Carboniferous, I believe the town of Burke was near the South Pole. Right, so you're talking about potentially life forms that obviously predating dinosaurs is one thing, but predating into, we go back through the Permian, through the Carboniferous, and then into this time in which our ancestors were these tetrapod type things on four legs, like crawling through the mud.
Exactly.
And you're still having, like you're talking about what we're witnessing here, systems like this are potentially running parallel in some regards to life that far back. That's incredible.
You look at pseudoscorpions and, you know, Amblypygidae and Schizomidae and stuff like that, and they're, you know, they're related to the earliest life forms that walked on the surface of the earth, quite closely related. They haven't changed that much, some of them. They've been around for a long time, which shows you the tenacity of life, doesn't it, eh? That to survive virtually unchanged that long. Amazing. Well, I like that setup. I think that dive is going to sit there nicely. It's not going to go anywhere. It's just sitting there on its side. It's going to sit there for a long time, I think. A couple of years. We'll come back and get it.
Awesome.
Surface cockroaches in caves, yeah, because this we're kind of pretty adapted to this environment anyway.
Oh, it goes way up in there.
Yeah, love, yeah, that's where the camp and altitude is. If you look above, you've got these massive winding fig roots coming down from the surface. This is quite a magical little chamber, this one here. I've just got an impressive place.
I'm Darren Brooks. I'm a caver, a speleologist. I explore caves in the Cape Range region. That's my hobby and sometimes work. This is a long-legged centipede. It belongs in a family called Scutigerida. We call them scutigeromorph centipedes. Some places they occur all over the world, but they're known in some places as house centipedes because people find them in toilet bowls and in baths and things like that where they get trapped and can't get out. But in the tropics, they can grow huge. In the true tropics, in Malaysia, they can grow up to 6 inches long in the body length, and then their legs can extend another 12 to 14 inches beyond the body each way. They in the Cape Range region, typically the largest ones you'll see have a body length of about 5 centimeters, and that's a large one. And most of the ones we see will be 2 to 3 centimeter body length, and their legs will extend out another 3 or 4 centimeters out beyond that. So these are, for a cave dwelling animal, these are quite a big animal, and they're not specifically a cave dweller. They're more an animal that which would tend to live in sheltered areas on the surface or small caves and rock shelters, and they can live in quite dry places, and we find them in the caves generally where the humidity is fairly high in the Cape Range area.
Oh wow, that's interesting.
Do you know what this is?
Well, it's a scorpion. I don't know whether it's a blind scorpion. There's a suspicion that it could, a blind scorpion occurs in these caves. We've got one from Barrow Island. We haven't had one from here yet. There's also a blind millipede just here, a live one, just crawling along the rock. You know the stone wall, this you go past with a big...
Could you explain the formation of this piece here?
Yes. Well, this is, again, this is a shawl. It's basically water running down a little ridge in the rock, so it's forming a strip of limestone, of calcite speleothem dripping off. And it's got preferential flows. There's a little bit of a straw there and tip of a straw there. And these little dogged edges, and that's caused by the crystal formation, the little edges, because the crystals form a certain pattern. So there's like little straws on the edge. For me. But this one is breaking down. You can start to see they're getting deeper wedges in there and starting to deteriorate. And that's just the natural breakdown of the rock over time, which is, when I say over time, it occurs over tens of thousands of years. It doesn't, like, you know, go dry last week and then form. It's a pretty old. It's a very slow process, that's for sure. Really interesting process.
So how do you see this as forming?
It's formed in columns. Stalactites come down and met up.
Right.
Got a distinct joint. Actually broken away in several spots too. Broken there, but it's still sitting there.
Yeah.
That's probably just full of subsidence. Even there, it's got to crack right through the whole thing.
So there's enough like movement around you. I mean, Phil Playford had said to me he thought that the tsunami that had formed like Shell Beach and things happened about 6,000 years ago, he put it at.
Yeah.
Around about that.
Yeah, okay. I think this sort of stuff, this fracturing here, this is probably just general floor subsidence.
Right.
Floor slowly creeping down. And you see that in a lot of caves where you'll see boulders and stalagmites and stuff on the floor, and stalagmites on boulders on the floor, often tilted at slight angles. And this is just general boulder rotation as soil and floor subsides underneath, or as more rocks dissolve underneath and chambers collapse in underneath, so they move around as they slowly sink down. I mean, sometimes these are, you know, fast collapse processes, but often it's just very gradual subsidence of the floors, and they slowly creep down with it. And often, I guess, you know, they probably get filled in cracks and joins, and sometimes they don't. They're not very active, like they're not active very much anymore. Those joints just slowly get larger as they come apart. These look pretty ancient, these ones. I mean, these are quite degraded, these decorations.
Very much.
Not very sharp crystalline. They're all breaking down over time. And they've got these cracks. So they've stayed there like that a long time.
They've been there a long time. How long would you calculate for something like this, judging by the amount?
I honestly have no idea.
Degradation.
I have no idea. We've had some stalagmite dating done up in the ranges, and we've got dates of 200,000 years for small stalagmites, but you know, I don't know how long this has been here. And this would be a great candidate for some dating, I reckon. I mean, even something like that, you could probably, you know, this is big enough, you could probably core drill this without making too much damage to it, and you could get a great sample through that in several spots to see what the time period for that is. And again, you're probably, you know, probably greater than 200,000 years, because that's when it was a lot wetter and things were forming more. Well, we've got one cave up in the range is great, the best decorated cave. We've got these great stalagmites growing on the floor, and then they basically stop, except for these little thin ones on top.
Yeah.
They grow up like little pipes coming out of them. Gives you an indication of the climate change at that time, when you know, the rainfall dropped right off. So all these stalagmites were forming reasonably fast and growing big fat stalagmites, and then these long thin ones on top of them. It's obviously a very slow dripping process. Yeah, pretty remarkable. It's an interesting little corner, this one.
It is.
Nice decoration just in here. And I like the fact it's really old stuff, you know, it's not fresh new stuff, it's different. Again, you've got, when you see fresh new stuff, you know, it's in the process of forming, so you understand that process. And then you look at these and you see these cracks in here, and it's degrading. You think, the age, what's the age of that now then? It's not fresh, it's not new. Mm. It hasn't formed in the last 100,000 years or 10,000 years. It's much older than that.
Mm. That is amazing.
But without proper investigation by the major samples, you'll never know how old it really is. You know, voids this size, under the right conditions, they could probably form, you know, in probably 25,000 years. You can get voids like this dissolved out of the rock without any drama, should be. But with a change in the climate, then they get pretty stable. And most of the big caves up in the ranges, they probably formed
a lot of bones in here.
Formed 15, 20 million years ago, a lot of those caves, and they just stayed the same.
Yep. Yeah, right.
That's actually a nice one right in front of the face. Oh, that one. That one's degrading too. They're starting to break apart on the teeth edge.
How does this form? Are you able to tell me? How does this happen?
This is a chaosite redeposition. Basically, when rain and water falls out of the sky, it picks up carbon dioxide. And so it forms a weak carbonic acid. When that lands on the surface, it can also pick up carbon dioxide from the soils, if there's any. And it dissolves a bit of the rock. So it dissolves some of the limestone. It passes through the micropores and cracks in the rock. When it comes out into the cave chamber, it's actually got that CO2 dissolved under pressure. So when it comes out into a cave chamber, the pressure is released. That means when the CO2 is released, it also has to release the limestone that it dissolved. So when it comes out in the cave and it seeps out here, it releases the CO2, it releases the lime it picked up on its way through, and deposits it as a secondary deposit, which we call calcite speleothems. It's just another form of the limestone. So the stalactites, the stalagmites, all those are formed by a chemical process of water picking up carbon dioxide, carrying it under pressure through the rock, dissolving lime because it can do that with the CO2 there. And when it comes out into a void, it can't contain that CO2 anymore because you know it needs to equalize the pressure through process of what we call degassing. So it releases the CO2 into the lower atmosphere, CO2 pressure atmosphere, and then it deposits that lime on the walls, if it's a fast drip, on the floor, on stalagmites and flowstones, and if it's a slower drip, on stalactites and straws and what we call here, sometimes we call them bacon strips or shawls. I wouldn't really call that a shawl because it's basically just a lime. It's sort of like shark tooth bacon strip there. So.
Yeah, I've seen the incredible shawls at Narrowcourt.
Ah, they're amazing, aren't they?
Right, we've completed our task. Our job was to install two data loggers, one in the water, one in the atmosphere. We've done that as a bonus. We've seen plenty of Stygo fauna, blind shrimps, blind fish, some interesting invertebrates, trog fauna, blind millipedes, schizomids, possibly assassin bugs. And Joe spotted a scorpion on the floor in the water, which we've collected. We've possibly got a blind scorpion in this cave, we don't know. We have blind scorpion from Barrow Island, so we probably should have a blind scorpion from Cape Range as well, though we haven't collected one just yet. Several months from now, we may know whether this is a blind scorpion, whether it's a new species. Very exciting trip, actually. For me, this is like, wow, this is a big thing. Funny enough, in the last email from Bill Humphreys from the WA Museum, he said, keep an eye out for a blind scorpion. And so we've collected a scorpion, and a few months from now we'll find out whether we've got the big prize. Because we do find ordinary scorpions get washed or dropped into caves occasionally. Because scorpions will crawl around the leaf litter and fall down these holes.
Yeah. I wouldn't imagine that they would be that colour though, would they? If they've come from, or they might be their fate.
Yeah, they've been soaked in water, it's hard to know whether they've changed colour or not.
Cross fingers.
Yeah, we had one scorpion from there and it wasn't troglobitic. It was found in a pool as well. I'm basically sitting upright and thought, well, this might be it, but it wasn't. That was 8 years ago. So we think this is the right environment. We might have something. Our target's just up here at the end of this gorge here on the hill there. This cave's, this cave's C215. Back in 88, when they established the Millering Centre, they built the Millering Centre in 88 and it opened then. And their first marine park manager was Sue Osborne. Well, I think her and her partner found this cave. They were just up walking, looking at kangaroos. Saw some under a fig tree. Looked under the fig tree and saw the big hole. So,
oh, right.
Yeah, happened to be up here at the time with the WA Museum. We're on a caving expedition, basically looking for cave fauna. And they told us about this cave, so we came around and had an explore. And we're like, wow, found a major feature.
Yeah, right.
This thing goes down through several layers of limestone, right down to the water table. It's a pretty good cave. And since then, we've had cave divers in, which have followed the water-filled tunnel, and it goes through 300 plus metres now for the heading. I think we're heading north, westish, I think, and down to about minus 22 metres. So it's deep as well, the water as well, you know. And typically, sort of it's quite freshish on the top, and then it sort of gets saltier and then hypersaline down deeper in the rock. So anyway, the reason I'm here today is because Bill Humphreys from the museum's given me a couple of data loggers. One's to go in the water so you can just measure the tidal fluctuations, and the other's basically an atmospheric monitor and barometric monitor, so we can measure differences in air pressure and see what that sort of changes are there, and CO2 levels, that sort of thing. Yeah. I don't come out here often, but occasionally there's a job to do, which is good. I enjoy it.
So you've got these set up throughout the park, do you?
Well, we've done these in the past. I haven't got any in place at the moment. But we've done them particularly on the coastal plains. We've put them in sinkholes and water holes, because that's where the Stygo fauna occurs. And I don't know if you've read much about this area, but Stygo fauna is interesting here, because it has a Gondwana connection.
Does it?
Yeah, so this stuff, sort of, most of the relatives of the animals that live here occur in disparate locations in the Northern Hemisphere. Because when they, you know, the Pangaea and broke apart and Gondwana split up, the Tethys Sea initially formed, the animals were probably living in that region, in the groundwater. And so their relatives have been dispersed around the world in the Northern Hemisphere with the other continent. And we've got the only spot in the Southern Hemisphere on the northwest coast of Australia.
Wow!
Where these animals occur. So,
that is
go in the blue holes of Bahamas, you've got this primitive crustacean called a remipede. Yeah. We've got remipedes here as well. It's the only other place in the world where we get remipedes, apart from that location in the Northern Hemisphere. So, yeah, it's a really interesting place, fauna-wise. And it's one of the contributors to World Heritage status, the fact that we've got this Gondwana connection, which isn't really, wouldn't even really advertise much at all, you know.
I didn't know.
And for a lot of people, they'd probably go, yeah, what does that mean? Because they don't understand the significance of the fact that this is the only place in the Southern Hemisphere where we've got that.
So that's remarkable.
Pretty interesting place, yeah. The terrestrial fauna we get is relical rainforest fauna. So typically its relatives occur in rainforest in Northern Australia, Southeast Asia. And we still have it here. But we only have it here because it's got the caves where they can retreat into. But they don't just occur here. They also occur in hard rock areas in the Pilbara block, like east and north of here, where they got some of the iron ore exploration and mining in the cracked rock.
Yep.
We also find relictual rainforest fauna in that rock too as well. Not all that rock is cracked rock either, so some of it doesn't contain anything. But areas where there is cracked rock, like on the mesas and things, they're finding relictual rainforest fauna when they do sampling. So our target's this bunch of figs just here. Yeah, so it's pretty cool area. It's pretty interesting, hey? Stuff here you wouldn't think would occur here, but it does. Look at this barren landscape. You think, wow, dry, desertified. What possibly could there be of interest here apart from animals that are sort of live in desert areas and have their unique adaptions to their dry climates? Well, the funny thing is that the cave animals don't have those adaptions to dry climates. Their answer was to retreat into niches where their climate was basically preserved. So you're looking at a climate that's like reminiscent of rainforest leaf litter. It's humid and it's stable all the time. So, and these animals, they don't survive outside the caves at all, because they're, you know, like most insects have like waxy wax coverings over their cuticles to stop them drying out and hold the moisture in. But you pull these ones out, they don't really have that. Look outside and you can almost literally see them shriveling up in the palm of your hand.
Really?
As they dry out, because the moisture just wicks straight out of them. Having said that, you know, occasionally, if you get a lot of moisture outside a cave entrance, we've had like rain, like, especially if you had a cyclone, it's tropical and it's hot outside and humid, you know, 95% humid, and it's hot and it's damp, they can actually move out of the cave environment as long as they're in contact with that moisture. This little world under there of relictual rainforest fauna, and then dating back, you know, this Stygo fauna, basically animals that live in the groundwater, which date back, you know, greater than 45 million years to the breakup of Gondwana and the formation
of the
Tethys Sea.
Right, so where do they place it in, or can it be dated back so far? Gondwana's got a pretty long history there.
Yeah.
It's like Mesozoic. Definitively, yeah, that's Jurassic.
Yeah, I can't earlier. Provide you the details of that, but it goes. They've got, you know, and through genetics they can actually do a lot of good tracing back through genes now to work out, you know, when splits occur between different populations.
I've heard that with the humans, that they're bottlenecking about 75,000 years ago with the Lake Toba.
Down to, you know, not very many people at all. 60,000 possible people, I think, was the thing I saw. 60,000 humans surviving or something at one stage.
I thought it was even less.
Branching out. Possibly less, maybe less than that. I'm just trying to think off the top of my head when I read that article about it. But the nearest, we've got a blind fish under here. We call it a blind gudgeon. It's a Mullerenga viridis. It does have a relative on Barrow Island, which we thought would be quite closely related. Because, you know, this area was, Barrow Island was like, we had, you know, interglacials where it was dry and stuff like that and flooded and all that sort of thing like that. And so we thought it would be quite closely related. But that thing goes back at separation through the gene tracking. I think it goes back a couple of million years separation, something like that. So it's a long separation between those two very near points.
Mm-hmm.
But the nearest distant relative we've got from the blind fish here is another blind fish that lives in caves in Madagascar, which is on the other side of the world more.
And Africa, was the first of the continental masses to break away from Gondwana.
These have all come down off the range too, you know, they've been swept down the gorge by big floods. You look at stuff like this very whitish rock, so you've got three main layers of limestone here. At the very top we've got Triala limestone, which is generally a very whitish sort of rock, a bit like this one here, but more crystalline. This is probably integrating into the layer below called Tolki limestone, and that sort of goes from white to pinkish. You look at a lot of these rocks, are quite pinkish in colour. Mm. And you do get some very pink rock, which is Tolki limestone. Eventually that goes down into Mandu calcarinite, which is a soft chalky limestone. You generally don't get bits of Mandu calcarinite down here because it's soft and crumbly and breaks up easy.
Mm-hmm.
But you do see Mandu calcarinite in the bottoms of the big gorges on the east side, like in the bottom of Shot Hole Canyon. And then, you know, when you're Charles Knight, you look down, you can look into the Mandu calcarinite below there. But this side's got a more complicated pattern. There's several interfingerings of sandstone and different limestone through here. There's sort of down here, this area here and further south, we've got a Pilgrimanna formation, which is a bit similar to the Tolki limestone, but formed at a different time on the seabed. So I was saying to Mandy the other day on the when we're out on the boat, you see those big bedding planes, you know, those horizontal cracks along the walls there.
Yeah.
So they're probably when the seabed was there, you know, and the little animals that live, the forams and all that, drop their shells on the seafloor and eventually become limestone.
Mm.
It's probably hiatuses, you know, because the temperature of the sea changes and the animal composition changes.
Yep. Yes.
Maybe they go to different types of shells or they're just not there. And typically geological terms, the hiatus, you think, okay, well it's only a crack, a few years, but you know, it might be 10,000, 100,000 years hiatus, something like that.
Yeah.
So it's interesting looking at those bedding planes, you know, it's quite big, distinctive bedding planes, and then water that goes down hits these bedding planes, forces its way through, opens them up. It's actually very large horizontal crack. It's quite an interesting part of the story, you know, to lay down on the limestone originally. And you can see some of those, more kangaroos. You can see some of those in here, look at the bedding plane straight through there, the big horizontal layers right through the rocks there.
Yeah.
So again, it's a major bedding plane area through there. And obviously, you know, sea temperatures change all the time. So there's obviously different changes in the population of the animals that live in the sea, the forams and things like that. So you get all these layers of limestone as it changes over thousands of years. So you can see all that in the rocks itself, and it's pretty interesting.
So how many people have done that?
Yeah.
Only two people have dived it.
So the first one put the guide rope there?
Yeah.
Baron, which is the hydro now. What does it say on there? Can you read that?
SWSM4902NW149.
Good on you, Bill. I just want to say, has that got a D in it something?
S2 Barrow DI500.
Barrow, so that must be the barometric one. So that other one must be the diver.
Okay.
Okay. I've got that the right way around. Be in trouble if I haven't. We destroy them. We say the silver one was the Barrow.
Yeah, that one says Barrow.
Yeah, that's the damage one. So there's
some roots coming down here.
Yeah, these are the fig tree roots that find their way into the cave. And I've been in caves, you know, they're 50, 60 metres deep, and these fig roots are still coming down through the ceilings. They're amazingly deep, these roots. I guess the trees have got to find somewhere to get moisture from, and they just work their way down through the rock. What gets me is how they manage to pump moisture all the way up to the tree at the top. That's just incredible. What a feat.